We have our package arrived today. This is from Palp Friction. Never worked with Palp Friction before, but Alexander's been a pleasure to deal with. Communication was great. We had some nice conversations. This was kind of a trade and then some gifts. I don't want to get into the details, but there were a few people that wanted to get a few things, so for here, for me and for the channel. So we just kind of did. This is not something that I really want to do. I don't really want to accept gifts, but this one person was pretty adamant about it. So, and then of course, one of the spiders in here was from Amy and Quentin for part of the trade that we're doing. I still have to send my stuff to them. And they still have two things to send to me. But, so let's get this thing open again. The addresses don't mean anything because they're shipping depots. Let's see, where's the, right there, huh? And I'm not sure how to actually do these unboxing videos. Because I just don't have anything to get up high enough to helicopter view. And of course I can't hold the camera. DeWalt. It's a nice knife. I've heard nothing but good things about Palp Friction. Shipping, packing, the animals are all healthy and well taken care of. Heat pack, still warm. And their infamous sticker, Palp Friction sticker. And a little paper. Well, I hate little paper. Let's see, let me grab something to put the little paper in. This will work. A lot of little paper. Here's the vials. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I think there might be one extra in there, which they're usually synonymous for semi-extras. So, I like these kind of packaging deals where they're in these little tiny things. It makes it easier to ship them, and it makes it easier sometimes to unpack them, especially if they're smaller. So let's get them out, and I'm going to bring you guys down lower so you could see them a little bit better, because that was kind of out of focus. Okay, so first, can you guys read it? I don't think you can you? I can't even see it. It's this light. There. A little bit better, not great, right? This is the Ornithoctonus oreotibialis. I think this one's a little over an inch. One. Here's the Acanthoscuria muscolosa. Two. The Gramostola grossa, which is already named. That's three. The Pteranochelys species arusha. That's four. The Ephibopus rufescens, which was the gift from Amy and Quentin. Here's the Orphanaicus philippinus. This is hopefully going to be a male. We're naming this one Cheddar. And looks like they sent a nice freebie. This was a... I'm not a huge pokey fan, but there are a few that I really do like. I think you guys know the Subpusca, of course, the Miranda, the Rufalata. And after looking at some of the pictures, I always wanted an Ornata. And this was something that I had on my... I don't know if I want to get list or not, but looks like they sent a nice little Piornata sling as a freebie. So thanks to them. So we're going to have to get these guys set up. I'm not sure the size of the Piornata is supposed to be about an inch and a quarter, inch and a half, somewhere in that area, I think, or right around an inch. I'm not 100% positive. So it'll be interesting to get these guys out. I'm not going to do this on camera because it's just too difficult for me to do. And I want to see the size of them before I decide what I'm going to put them in. I have three softball enclosures set. Well, not set, but they're empty. And two baseball cubes that are empty, or three baseball cubes that are empty. I have plenty of stuff to put this guy in. There's all kinds of 40 dram vials and 50 dram vials and the paint containers from Hobby Lobby if I need to use something bigger. On top of the microphone there. I was hoping the Piorusha would go... Oops. Yeah, let's just shake them all up and scare the crap out of them, huh? I was hoping the Piorusha was big enough to go into one of the small display cases like this. But we'll see. There's the male, Serio Cosmos Aurea. He built another sperm web last night, so he's been tapping and raring to go. I'm not... I want to put them back together again, but I'm kind of leery because I really think that the pairing was successful. And if she is already bred and successfully bred, or she's gravid yet because she has to produce the eggs, but if she knows that she's set, she won't want to mate with him and she may eat him. And I would rather... It's very, 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 very windy here today. I mean, super windy. If I will try to put him in real quick, and if she doesn't go to him or she doesn't tap relatively quickly, then I will take him back out, because at least maybe somebody else has a female that we can send him to breed with that female also, because this is not a species that you see a lot around. I was fortunate enough to get her my female 2.5 years ago. And then I got another one that I sent to my friend about a year later. And that one didn't live. So I only know about 3 or 4 people that have these. And I know that some people that... I know that Alexandra... Yeah. Yeah. Alexandra and Tanya from Palp Friction and Fear Not Tarantulas both said that they would take slings if I produce them. And there's a ton of people that, like I said already, were... begging me for slings before I even knew if she was gravid or not. So we'll see what happens with her. I don't think the Serio Cosmos species is a double clutch kind of species, so it's probably just going to be whatever comes out of that first sack, if we get one and she successfully wraps it and the eggs actually hatch, which I'm really, really hoping for. So I did go to Hobby Lobby and pick up a few more enclosures. The size that I just showed you, I picked up 4 of those, and then 3 baseball cube enclosures for whatever I need to for these guys, if that's what I need to do. So yeah, I will get these guys all unpacked and figure out where I'm going to put them, and then I'll show you guys what I actually end up doing with them coming up next. Okay, so. Success. Everybody's out of their little tiny shipping sample vials into different actual vials. I wanted to see the size of everybody so I can decide on who's going where. So if we start here on the left. This is the... see if you guys can see. This is the Orphanaicus filipinus, which is, it's probably about an inch and a quarter. So I feel pretty comfortable with this species setting it up in a softball enclosure. We'll give it some nice deep substrate about halfway full, and give it a little starter burrow and some things to do some webbing on, and we'll get that one in a softball enclosure. So we'll have some nice plastic to see. You can see right now it's still brown. It won't get orange for another molt or two. So when they really start to orange out. They get to be about that inch and a half to inch and three quarter mark is when you'll start to see some of the orange. So this guy will be in a softball enclosure. This little dude is so stinking cute. I can't believe it. Little fuzzy Postlethoria ornata. This one was all over me. What I used to, of course, when I open them up, I always open them up in something bigger. And I use that big, huge basketball basketball display case so I could see what I was doing from the sides, which made it much easier. And this one come flying out of that little vial, up the paper towel, up my arm, back down, around that thing, back up my arm. It's just kind of funny the way it's flailing and the look. This was the freebie that they sent to me, and you can already see some of the interesting patterning, even at this size. So that's the Pistillotheria ornata. I think this is the Mysore ornamental. I have to check that. Not great with some of the common names, especially of spiders I don't have or haven't had before. Of course, we know the Orphanaceus filipinus is the Philippine tangerine. This is the Ornithoctinae oreotibialis. Again, about an inch and a quarter. Decent size. So this one is will be perfectly fine set up in a softball enclosure. Probably would be okay in a baseball cube, actually, because it just digs. So it's actually a little smaller. It's about the same size as some of the ones that are in the baseball enclosure. So we'll have to decide what we want to do with this one, because it does just basically burrow, and that's all you're really going to see of it. They're pretty much like a sea libitum, or not actually sea libitus and or L libitum, right? Whichever one's right. I still don't know which one's right. So yeah, that's the Ornithoctinus oreotibialis. I think this is called the gold fringed tiger, maybe. I don't know. Earth tiger, gold fringe, earth tiger, or just gold fringed. Wanted one of these before a long time ago, and then I this is one of those ones that, you know, I almost pulled the trigger on about four or five times and it never did. So I decided this would be a good opportunity to get this one. This is the little teeny tiny Acanthus scuria muscolosa or musculosa. I don't know, you guys can't probably see that because my thumb wants to. There's a little tiny guy there. This we'll put into a vial with some substrate, just like I've been doing with. It'll probably go in a vial in the back here. This one here. That's probably where I'll put it. Kind of the same deal I have with my Brachypalma vagans, who's ready to move out of that enclosure into one of those matchbox car enclosures. So we'll see what we're going to do with that. I don't know what the name of this is, black velvet, I think, but I'm not. There's so many black velvets. I don't know, you know, if there's a front end of that name or if it's just the, you know, Brazilian black velvet or Peruvian black velvet. I'm not really quite sure, but that's what I believe the common name is. Very timid. Oh, you're not focusing. This one took a little while to get to crawl. It was kind of curled up. It didn't really want to move. So I was a little tiny bit worried about, but not too worried about it. So we'll get this guy in some dirt and it should be okay. Here is the, this spider is just absolutely stunning, even at this size. Just unbelievable, really. It'll be a lot easier if you guys see him when, let me get the Bailey hair off my thumb there. Or that's not on my thumb, is it? Nope, it's attached to the enclosure. Nice. Dog hair everywhere. It's actually snapped in the lid, so you're gonna have to live with it. Pteranochelys species Arusha. Very, very dark colored, basically P. marinus, but it's not a P. marinus. They look pretty similar. These are from Tanzania, same place, pretty close to where the Pteranochelys cordatus are from. This is, of course, from Arusha, which it's a region, or the region Arusha region, which is the gateway to Serengeti, and leads to Mount Everest. Right? Mount Everest? Yeah, Mount Everest. I think Mount Everest. or Kilimanjaro, sorry, Kilimanjaro, not Mount Everest. What the hell am I talking about? Kilimanjaro. So the Pteranochilus cordatus are found right around the base of Kilimanjaro in that area. So these are kind of like the next region over is the way I'm looking at it on the map. Again, I could be completely wrong. This is a species I've never really seen available before. I know people have them because I've seen posts on arachnoboards from, I think, 2005. So it's not like they're new. I've just never really seen them. And is this possibly just Pteranochilus cordatus? I don't know. The coloring seemed to look different between the pictures that I've seen on arachnoboards between this species and the cordatus. There's a little bit of, I think, the femurs on the cordatus are really, really dark. They're like a blacker. And then you get that gold banding where this one's got the gold banding, but the legs all seem to have the same color all the way down. So that's that one. This is Ephibopus slings are just top notch. You can't beat that. This is a burgundy skeleton or the Ephibopus rufescens. Now I'm a huge fan of the Ephibopus murinus, and I enjoy so far the Ephibopus cyanonathus. But looking at this sling, and when you see this one out, the coloring on this one itself, which it keeps that banding coloring, you can barely see it. Let me see if I can open it up and it doesn't want to take off on us. Maybe you guys will be able to see in there. I don't know. Maybe not. Anyway, the front legs of this thing are just absolutely spectacular. And it's got the greenish hue to the abdomen. It's got lighter back legs. So the back legs are darker. Front legs are a little bit lighter. Seeing the pictures of this thing as an adult are just spectacular. I'm really, really pleased to get one of these. This is definitely a softball enclosure contender. It'll dig just like the other Ephibopus will. And last but not least, cat, here's your envy. This is the Gramostola grossa. I'll see if I can take the lid off without it taking off. Again, this one crawled around on me too, but it may want to come out. I don't know. I don't know how much you're going to see of it. There's the Gramostola grossa. They get a nice black with a little, I think it's like a reddish around the carapace. Now the ring around the carapace there. So there's some ifs, ands, or buts about this one, if it's actually a grossa or if it's actually the Gramostola iorangi. There's some, I think this whole Gramostola genus, once it gets, once somebody works on the reclassification of it, which I think a lot of people don't even want to touch, I think you're going to see a lot of the Gramostola species change from what they are to something different. This being one, I'm not going to get into the other ones because I didn't really see much of the information, but this one does seem like this one probably should be Gramostola iorangi instead of the Gramostola grossa, but for now, we're just going to call it Gramostola grossa, or what people are saying, you can call it the Gramostola grossa hobby form. So this one will definitely go into a softball cube as well. We'll see if it digs or it just wants to walk around. So now my next adventure is to get the homes set up for them and get them in them. I will probably start with this one here because I need this enclosure for the Acanthoscuria muscolosa. And we'll go from there. So I will show you the enclosures, and once they're all done and set up, and we'll go from there. So here's the housing part. Well, everyone's housed. Not really the actual housing part, but everyone is in their home now. So I wanted to, let me get this set. I wanted to show you guys real quick, Palp Friction, www.palpfrictiontarantulas.com. Go check them out. You know, you get 5 stars from me, 2 thumbs up, high five, whatever you want to do. It was a really pleasurable experience working with them. Again, this stuff was basically one trade, one gift from a friend, and then something, a couple people from YouTube, I don't want to mention anybody's names, kind of wanted to have some new things brought into the collection, even though I didn't need them. And they kind of paid for this stuff, really. So what we have and what we did, let's start with the smallest one first. Here is the, you can see the little spider crawling in the background there. This is the Acanthoscuria muscolosa. Again, just in a vial of dirt. It'll dig if it wants to, probably won't. This will be, you know, cricket legs and small things of that nature that will be feeding this little dude. I gotta make sure that I keep the right vials with the right people so I can put the labels on. I haven't done that yet. This is Cheddar, the Orphanicus filipinus. You might be there we are right there. Okay, softball enclosure, probably a tad bit bigger than it needs. It probably could have went into a football helmet enclosure, but this is one of my favorite species overall, so I kind of wanted to make sure that I didn't have to rehouse it real quick. We'll watch it grow for 3 molts or so in here before we need to move it into something different. It's pretty basic of a setup. There's 2 pieces of bark there. This is bark from outside. Stuff's been in my house for years, probably. At least the last few years. I have a whole entire box full of pieces of bark that we found from trees that had, you know, rotted or fell apart, or one that was struck by lightning. So all I did was kind of crisscross them, and you could see the hole right there that I put in there for the spider. Again, these guys will burrow, but Cheeto never really burrowed down. It kind of just, like I said, it made like a den, and it kind of covered the den with webbing and every enclosure that it's been in, really. It hasn't really dug a deep hole. So I expect this one to probably do the same thing. I'm hoping that it'll utilize that area there, kind of web it up, and then we'll be able to see it. Like I said, if you guys saw it in the vial, it's still brown, which they are. They look like a Chilobrachy species because they are brown, like a Huahine almost. That same kind of coloring as when they're small slings like this. And then they get the coloring right around the 1.5-inch mark. They'll start to orange up a little bit. By the 2-inch mark, they're pretty prominently orange. So we'll look forward to that. Here is the Pteranochelys species Arusha. I think I already went over the whole little Tanzania thing. I'm excited about this one because, again, it's something different. I don't know anybody actually that has one of these personally. I know they're out there in the trade. Like I said, I've seen stuff from arachnoboards, or I saw stuff on arachnoboards from 2005, I believe. So they have been around for a while. I just personally don't know anybody, any of my friends that own one of these. So maybe some people from the UK may have some, but not here in the United States. First time I've ever actually, I've seen them for sale. So that one's exciting to me. Trying to think of some kind of cool African name for this one. So we'll come up with something, you know, like the Cerrado Jar Starlingi's name, Sandari, which is I think that's a town or a province. And then there's also a spider in that genus named Sandari, the Cerrado Jar Sandari. So I thought that name was kind of cool. And I can't remember the whole details about that. I have to go back over my notes to figure out how I come up with Sandari. I know I looked at the map and kind of where they were from, and that name kind of stuck with me, and I liked it, so that's what I used. Here is the Ornithoctonus species. Yeah, just no species. Ornithoctonus oreotibialis. Oreotibialis. You can see the spider there. You can see the legs. Again, this is a basic setup, baseball cube with this probably 1.5 inches, almost 2 inches of dirt for this one. This one will act just like a Cerrado Jar, or Cerrodojaris lividus. Cerrodojaris. Cereopagopus lividus. Excuse me for my misinformation on names today. I can't seem to get anything right speaking-wise. I've already done this part of the video once before, and I butchered everything I did, and I'm butchering it again. Every time I say a genus name that starts with an O, Ornithoctonae, Orphanicus, and this Ornithoctonus, I want to put species in there because of the Ornithoctonae species Laos and the Ornithoctonae species Malta I'm supposed to be getting in. I always want to put that species in there, and they're not. This is an Ornithoctonus oreotibialis, Orphanicus filipinus. So yeah, another Asian species. I think, like I said, I think it's called the golden fringe or something like that. So there's that one. Then there is this one here, which is, this is the one that Kat was the most interested in. We've talked about this species a handful of times on Messenger, and
So she was really anxious to see this one come in. She's the one that named it because she was kind of jealous that I was getting one. She asked me if I would name it Envy, which I obliged to. So that's the Gramostola grossa. I'm not 100% sure what the common name for this one may be. Again, basic setup. This is a softball enclosure. I gave it, that one's the only one I actually put a water dish in there. But I gave it just a piece of cork bark here. I didn't dig a burrow for it. If it wants to dig, it will. There's plenty of substrate in there for it to do it. I didn't want a starter burrow this one because this one's a little bit more cocoa fiber than it is some of the other mixture stuff, so it's not as firm. If I see it wanting to burrow and it's struggling a little bit to maintain that burrow, then I will change the substrate mixture out to something that'll hold the burrow just a tad bit better. Cocoa fiber is fine, but for most species that don't web a lot, it doesn't hold a burrow very well. Okay, this here is the Ephibopus rufescens. This is the burgundy skeleton. This spider, out of everything that I got in, honestly, this is my favorite. This one here. And hopefully you'll see why. For those of you that own them, I'm sure that you can give me a little bit more information on exactly what they kind of adult out as and what they look like as adults. But when I saw this one out of the vial itself, now you could see the front legs are dark. So legs L1 and 2 and R1 and R2 are darker. That's the burgundy, the real deep brown. And then you could see the back legs are a little lighter brown. Maybe that's more of a burgundy, I guess. And then you see the banding. That's like a creamish yellowish banding. When it was out sitting on the substrate after I put it in here, because it crawled right out of the little vial, right onto the ground and sat there. So I had to take a picture of it. It almost reminds me of, it's not like a Salmopaeus victori, but it reminds me of the way that the coloring pattern is on a Salmopaeus victori. So this is my Salmopaeus victori, the Ephibopus rufescens. I'm really digging this dude already. Definitely out of everything that came in, this is my favorite. I was really excited to get the grossa, but I did not realize how beautiful this spider actually is. And I'm a big fan of the dark colors, so, you know, browns and blacks. I really dig, so they're rad, right, Kat? So be on the lookout for a lot of videos and a lot of pictures of this guy. I will post a picture that I took of it on my Eerie Arachnids Facebook page. So if you haven't gone there to check things out, I haven't put anything on there in a while, so I'm going to start adding more content to that. I just need to figure out how that page works a little bit better than what it does. Because I do want to put some text and information stuff on there. Upcoming things, places that, you know, things that I'm working on there. So I don't have to do as many update videos. I can do some stuff there that you guys can go and check out in your free time whenever you want to. Instead of me uploading update videos every week, you know, on one or two things. I can do one big upload or update video maybe twice a month where we get some molts or something like that so you guys can actually see them on video. But I want to try and utilize that Eerie Arachnids page a little bit more. And of course, once we do the contest with the Lassiador para ibana from Fear Not Tarantulas at the Tinley March show, there'll be details there and you'll have to go to that page and like that page. And be a subscriber here at Eerie Arachnids and be in the United States and be attending the Tinley show. Hopefully there's at least more than one or two of you guys that are going to attend the Tinley show that might be interested in getting yourself a free Eerie Arachnids Lassiador para ibana from Fear Not Tarantulas. So that video will be coming mid-February on what we need to do. And hopefully we'll have everybody set and ready the week before Tinley so I can draw the name, and then I will give Tanya the name and I will notify the person that won and do a video about it and let you know what you need to do to go pick it up. So this is the Pisolatheria ornata. This is the last one. This was the freebie. You can't beat freebies, especially when I talked to Alexandra, there was a bunch of spiders on the list that I was debating on what I wanted to get. And, you know, I wanted to know some sizes of certain ones, and this one was one of them. The piece of Theria subfusca, I'd like to get another one of those, the Highlands. There were a handful of them that I just wanted to know what the sizes were so I can kind of get an idea of what I wanted. And this is one of the ones that I asked about. Ornatas are beautiful. I've never actually physically or seen one in person ever. I've never seen one in person. I've just seen pictures of them. And I know that they get mixed up with Rufalatas a little bit. So the coloring, you know, is somewhat similar, I believe. I think there's a little bit of greens in these too. So I'm really, really anxious to raise this one up. I know these ones tend to be a little bit more bitey, and I know some certain YouTubers have, one was bit by one of these. I'm not mentioning any names, but one was bit by one of these. I can't remember if it was during a rehouse or during a breeding video or whatever it was, but he ended up having to go to the hospital for it. He's still alive, so nothing really major happened to him, but yes, I'm really thrilled to have this this one in my collection, and again, thanks to Jared and Alexandra from Palp Frictions for the gift, and I hope you guys enjoyed everything here and are looking forward to watching these guys grow with me. And once again, we'll do the Palp Friction. I love their logo. It's really, really cool. www.palpfrictiontarantulas.com. Go check them out. If you go check them out and you decide to buy something, tell them I sent you so that they know that you watched my video and saw them and you got recommended to go see them from me. Not that it's going to gain me anything. I don't want anything more, but I just want them to know that, you know, I was appreciative of them. Of course, I'll send them a message here in a minute to let them know everything came in good, healthy, and looks superb. And hopefully my Iberoporosauritoma made the trip. I always worry about sending my spiders off whenever I mail. I never sleep very well because I'm not a professional packer. I packed that one and the Haplopus species Columbia large a little different than I normally do. I used little condiment cups, the 4-ounce condiment cups, gave them a smaller area to be in because it's winter, and a little bit more padding and a little bit more styrofoam in the boxes with the heat pad. And the way I set up the heat pad was a little bit different than I normally do. I think I still put the barrier. No, I didn't put the barrier in with that one, I don't think. I think I put the heat pack on top above a layer of paper, the newspaper. So hopefully I'll hear from them soon saying that that guy came in okay, because I always, always, always worry, especially when we do, you know, when I do a trade for somebody. You know, a sale is different because if I sell something and the little dude doesn't make it there, I can refund the money for the spider at least. When I do a trade, it's kind of hard to do that. So, you know, you really, what do you do from there, you know? So, all right, well, we're probably going to be about, I don't know, a little right around 25 to 30 minutes overall with this video. So, hope you guys enjoyed it, and we'll talk to everybody soon. Have a great day and the rest of your week.